part theoretical reflection on thinking and rethinking the history of Muslims in the Balkans and those in Central and Southeast Asia in the early 20th century, in part historical reading of the events that accompanied Albania's partition from the Ottoman Empire at the onset of World War I, looking at how this event resonated with Muslim subjects of the British Empire and gave rise to a formation of the pan-Islamist movement. In other words, I want to look at the story of World War I, or I want to take the story of World War I, rather, to the peripheries of both empires, the Ottoman and the British Empire. Inasmuch as we can think of India as the periphery of the British Empire and the Balkans, that of the Ottoman Empire. The relationship of these peripheries is generally footnoted in the larger context of great power politics and major historical junctures, such as World War I, World War II, and so forth. However, today I want to look at the relations between these peripheries outside the dominant powers, where political formations that emerge at the beginning of the 20th century, while still very much tied to the centers of power, in this case Istanbul and London, they nonetheless organize their own political projects and imagine futurities that aren't always compatible with the geopolitical strategies of the centers. I look at how European interventions and excursions into Ottoman territories were politicized by Muslims in Central and South Asia, giving rise to a pan-Islamist movement that precedes the pan-Islamist movement of World War I. I say precedes because we are usually told that pan-Islamism was an Ottoman project, a last effort by Mehmed V, pressured by CUP government, to appeal to all Muslims to travel the Caliph's enemies of the Ottoman Empire as the Ottoman Empire joins the Central Powers in the Great War. Recent work has also tried to point out that pan-Islamism may have been more of a German project than an Ottoman one. After all, the Intelligence Bureau for the East, set up by Germany in 1914, operated in extensive networks of agents and money which connected pan-Islamist activists across the world from Kashgar to Marrakesh. Yet the assumption that pan-Islamism was an Ottoman or a German or a joint project not only stands on account that pan-Islamism emerged with World War I as a political tactic, but also based on the dominant Eurocentric considerations of history, still burdened by Orientalist assumptions. The operating logic at play here is that there was no possibility that people in the villages and towns of Albania or India could even connect with each other prior to World War I, let alone articulate a pan-Islamist movement. Moreover, the impossibility of a grassroots political pan-Islamist movement that transgressed the geopolitical borders of the time is also based on what in queer theory, particularly Elizabeth Friedman calls heterohistory, or the understanding that there's always has to be the bigger person behind the subaltern formation, for the subaltern can never really talk on its own. Moreover, post-World I national histories have frequently ignored supranational movements in favoring singular nationalist movement towards the establishment of the nation-state. The role of the Paris Peace Conference in this regard cannot be understated. Like Turkey, Albania sought to sanitize its national independence from any pan-Islamic impulses and struggles, seeking to orient its nationalist project towards a narrowly defined Eurocentric modernizing futures, which saw pan-Islamic resistance as a fanatical movement at best. Nationalist narratives and political projects sought to synchronize Muslims in the Balkans with the historical timeline of Europe, limiting the reading of Muslim histories in the Balkans to European memory and mythology. Revisiting pan-Islamist peripheral movements, then, is not only important to understand the plurality of anti-colonial resistance from India to Albania, but also in exploring the vastness of possibility imagined by Islamist activists to remake the Ummah after the Ummah. In November of 1912, Albania declares independence. A group of Albanian landowners and nationalists with Austro-Hungarian backing had declared independence from the Ottoman Empire. Yet the Albanian independence, unlike the independence of Greece, Serbia, and Bulgaria, could not rely on its Christian Europeanness to celebrate its partition from Turkey and return to its rightful mother. To accommodate an overwhelming Muslim majority population loyal to the Caliph, the nationalists framed their project around existential questions of staying in Europe and becoming European, or performing hijra and moving eastward together with the leaving Ottoman empires. There is, quote, there is no alternative, wrote Samish Frashri, quote, Albania is part of the geography of Europe, end quote. As a result, the Declaration of Independence comes to be seen by a majority of Muslim Albanians as a threat to their way of life. The Muslim ulama at the time refuses the dichotomous and extreme ends of the argument, calling the work of the nationalist a fitna. One of the noted Muslim clerics of the time, Mustafa Androci, would write that, quote, if we are being claimed by Europe because we are part of the European geography, then how can Europe claim India so far away from its borders, end quote. Yet despite the internal resistance and in the chaos of the Balkan Wars, and to avoid further tensions between Austro-Hungarian, Italian, Greek, and Serbian claims to what was being left behind from the leaving Ottoman Empire, Britain recognized the independence of Albania and led the establishment of the International Control Commission, a European-wide mission, first of its kind, along with an international military and police force very similar to the EU missions in Bosnia and Kosovo today, actually, to look after and govern Albania until such time as Albanians had been trained and Europeanized enough to be fit to govern themselves. The powers also agreed on a German prince, Wilhelm Zuvit, to be the ruler of Albania. In February 1913, several months after the Declaration of Independence, Kadri Bey Peçini, a noted Muslim intellectual from Albania based in Istanbul, would write to Dervish Bey Piçaku, who was based in Durres and was organizing a Muslim resistance. Quote, the Turks are worse than the Europeans. They don't mind to see us go. They would like to trade Rumeli for less than our own Başıbuzuks, end quote. He further urges the Dervish Piçaku to, quote, please remind the ulema to talk of the faith of our brethren in Bosnia, Serbia, and in Greece, to remind them of what awaits the Muslims when they shun the shadow of the Caliph, end quote. In another letter, in April of the same year, he writes again, quote, the Pashas won't hear of helping, but I have met several Beks from India. Here he's talking about Ansari and Zulfikar Khan, who had arrived in Istanbul as part of an Indian mission sent from Muslims, the All-Muslim Indian League, to Istanbul to assist with the humanitarian disaster happening at the time. Want to set up villages with money from our brothers in India for Rumeli Muhajirs. I asked them if they could help, and they have replied positively, end quote. Muslims in British India had started to show interest and frequently send aid to Muslims in the Balkans. The first record of interest on the Balkan subject among Muslims in British India are reports by British officers as early as 1897, when the Greek-Turkish War of Thessalia had aroused strong sentiments among the population of Lahore. One Husnam Mills, for instance, reporting in the Civil and Military Gazette, writes that, quote, as the Turks waged wars on Christians on the plain of Thessaly, the Muslims here too are inspired to exterminate the infidels from India, end quote. While details on the formation of larger movement, pan-Islamist movement, are scarce, and much more research needs to be done to understand this period, the Italian invasion of Tripoli in 1911 finds a pan-Islamist movement already formed. The political organization behind the movements are well documented in the political activities that Muslims under British rule undertook to pressure Britain to condemn the invasion. The Pakistani historian Abdul Rauf writes brilliantly and chronicles the public reading of newspapers and prayers in mosques throughout India on the situation in Tripoli. British official reports note how the decision to block the Ottomans in Egypt on their way to Tripoli was a political move that had angered Muslim subjects of the British Empire. The onset of the Balkan Wars that would follow in the following year would further the movement from political sentiments to solidarity. In the meantime, the ambitious European-wide project to, quote, as in the words of the British ambassador to Albania, to turn Muslims into Europeans, through the International Control Commission, was designated not only to establish a state infrastructure, but to also make citizens out of soldiers, and through various other political processes, such as building civil society. Yet the International Control Commission and Prizvi were failing to integrate the various minorities in Albania, particularly the Christian minorities of Albania, who in the meantime had their own projects with competing Albania going on. The Orthodox in the south had declared autonomous Republic of Vorio Epirus, and in the north the Catholic tribes were unhappy with being promised by Albanian, by Austro-Hungarian and Italian agents in the last three decades, ending up soldiers in someone else's army. To forge a national unity and deal with the cracks that were appearing everywhere, the International Control Commission engaged in humanitarian work and publicizing this humanitarian work to gain the sympathy of the people. So it is in this background that a popular Muslim uprising starts to take place in central Albania. The initial resistance to the International Control Commission was localized and isolated. In response to an appeal by the Muslim ulema to the Ottoman administration that had been forwarded to Ahmed Izzet Pasha, whom the pro-Ottoman Muslim ulema in Albania had offered to become the king of Albania in 1913, Izzet Pasha replied that, quote, "There is no hope for an insurrection yet. Albanians don't know each other from Kaza to Kaza, and the supporting of the uprising in Albania would mean confronting Britain," end quote. Having resigned hope of a direct Ottoman intervention, the movement gathered momentum around the passing of the Organic Statute, which was to become the provisional constitution of the new Albanian state. In June 1914, Sheikh Haji Chamili led the Muslim uprising, challenging the legitimacy of the Albanian state and its partition from the Ottoman Empire. The insurgents sent an official demand to the International Control Commission for the removal of the prince and the appointment of the Muslim prince, and that Albania be returned to the sovereignty of the Caliphate as an autonomous province, and that Arabic be restored as the rightful alphabet. Chamili, who is a Sheikh of the Melami Tariqa, also demanded the abrogation of land privileges that the Albanian aristocracy had required through the so-called Organic Statute. The statute transformed all Arazi Mirie, crown lands, which were Ottoman-owned public property, bestowed for use to loyal subjects, to Arazi Memluke, or private lands, or privately owned lands. As the benefactors of these reforms were the small group of land-owning Albanian nationalists who had declared independence and were supporting the International Control Commission, Sheikh Chamili demanded the abrogation of these rights and the subsequent redistribution of land to the peasants. In less than 2 months, the insurgents seized most of the territory of the Albanian state, and Durrës, which was then the capital, remained the only territory controlled by Prizvit and his provisional Albanian government. The news of an uprising in Albania made waves throughout British India. Abul Kalam Azad would write of an uprising in the news Al Hilal in India and call for funds and volunteers to be sent to Albania. Kalam Azad himself would travel from Delhi to Thessaloniki to deliver the gathered funds and meet with the representatives of the insurgents. In 2 weeks, the insurgents had won every battle with the International Control Commission and the provisional Albanian government. Several Dutch soldiers serving in the International Gendarmerie were taken prisoners, and later Colonel Thompson, which was the head of the security forces of the International Control Commission, was assassinated by the insurgents. By August 1914, all of Albania was under the control of the Muslim insurgents.